towards the February and the next session that we are planning to discuss. So this could serve as a criterion standard for what can you expect in that particular session. Even though I'm not going to discuss much of images today, but still this is going to be just a very, very simple discussion. So what are the basics? See, that's what it is. I hope many of you students are undergrads and maybe a few are interns, by the way. We'll start with the very, very basic things about ECG. So whenever we talk about an ECG, so you know, what do you mean by ECG? ECG really means something called as electrocardiogram. But the thing is that ECG is actually different from another terminology called as EKG. Or we can simply write as electrogram. So if I ask you the question, so what do you mean by electrogram and how it is different from the routine term called electrocardiogram? So can anyone answer? So what is the difference between an electrogram and an electrocardiogram? Anyone, by the way? I think there are quite a few students out there. In fact, a lot of students are there. I think 18 by this time have joined. So can anyone tell? So what do you mean by electrogram versus what do you mean by electrocardiogram? So no, isn't it? So if you're not able to tell that, so let me tell the answer for you. So electrocardiogram is nothing but you record the electrical activity of the heart from the surface. So you keep the leads or the skin of the chest or probably the limbs, and you're recording the electrical activity of the heart from the surface. So this is what we mean by something called as electrocardiogram. But when you keep the leads inside the heart, for example, you cannulate the great veins like internal jugular vein, and you enter through the superior vena cava, and you go into the right atrium, and you go into the right ventricle, and there you have access to the SA node, and there you have access to the AV node, and a lot of other stuff, other connecting bundles in between. So if you're going to record the electrical activity of the heart from the inside of the heart, and that is what we call it as electrogram. So what is the difference? The difference is very simple. So if you are going to record the electrical activity of the heart from the surface, it means by an ECG, so that is an electrocardiogram. And if you're going to record the electrical activity from the inside of the heart through the invasive leads we talk about, so that is what we refer to as an electrogram. So you need to be very clear. So what is the difference between an electrocardiogram and an electrogram first? As far as the electrocardiogram is concerned, so we call it as the basic 12-lead ECG, to be honest. So 12-lead ECG is what is considered to be the standard, to be precise. But nevertheless, we'll see the pitfalls of the 12-lead ECG, why 12 leads are not enough later on when we're going into the discussion, into the depth of the discussion. That time we'll be able to discuss that, but not right now. But apart from that, will they be able to find out all the electrical activity of the heart? Answer is no. So electrocardiogram is not very capable of finding out all the electrical activity that is going on within the heart. So in general, for example, you have the nodal activity. For example, you have an SA nodal activity, you have AV nodal activity, and you have the bundles activity, like His bundle activity. You have something called as the Purkinje fiber activity, or more than that, we can talk to the bundle branch activity, the activity of the bundle branches. All these things are some things which cannot be found out by electrocardiogram. That's very important. So for example, you might be wondering, so what I'm talking about, so you have SA node, so which means it gives rise to the P wave. No, actually not. So when you talk about an ECG and when you talk about a P wave, you know what a P wave really means? P wave really means it is atrial depolarization. So which means it's very clear that P wave means atrial depolarization, which means the chamber electrical activity, the electrical activity of a particular chamber like ventricles or atrium can be found out using electrocardiogram, but you can't really find out the nodal depolarizations. For example, even though SA node fires, that results in firing of the atrium. So SA node first depolarizes and the atrium depolarizes, and this is what is going to result in the P wave. So what I'm talking about is it's the atrial depolarization that's going to result in the P wave, even though the reason for atrial depolarization usually in normal patients is SA nodal depolarization. But you don't really get anything in the ECG due to SA nodal depolarization. There is no discernible waveform in the ECG, the surface ECG, due to SA nodal depolarization, or probably even due to AV nodal depolarization, or probably even due to bundle of His or bundle branches, conduction, or all this stuff. So all these things can be found out using the electrogram. So that is the basic difference. So electrogram, we're using an electrogram, you can find out how and when the SN node fires. You can find out when and how the AV node fires. You can find out exactly when the HIS node fires. You can find out exactly when the bundle branches fires. All these things can be found out by this electrogram, but you cannot do that using electrocardiogram. Electrocardiogram is kind of an assumption. So if you have a P wave at a particular location, you think that it has to come from the SA node firing. So retro, I mean, maybe hypothetically you can understand that probably the SA node is working or not working. That's how you do. So, but directly you'll not be able to find out whether SA node or AV node is firing using the surface electrocardiogram. So this is the first difference that you need to know. So in a nutshell, so what I wanted to tell is electrocardiogram is basically a kind of a surface measurement, whereas electrogram is a kind of an internal measurement using the inside of the heart. The leads will be going into the heart. So this is what we mean, difference between the electrocardiogram and the electrogram. And before that, we need to know about the paper. So before going into the ECG, we need to know about the paper that is used to record the ECG. So, you know, the ECG paper looks something like that. So, you have a big sheet of paper, and in that, you will be having a variety of lines like this. So, you'll be knowing that, right? So, you'll be having multiple lines like this. So sorry for that, even though these are perfect squares, because I'm drawing it with my own hand, I'm not able to really draw very symmetrically. So even though these are perfect squares, don't worry about that. Clear? So, but I mean, these are called as large boxes. When you take the full paper and you see this, these are what we refer to as something called as large boxes. This is a large box, by the way. But if you take one large box, this one particular large box, and you want to zoom it in, so what really happens? So let us zoom one large box. So this is the one large box which I've taken, and I'm zooming it in. If you zoom it and see this particular large box, it itself is going to contain 25 squares. So which means you're going to divide this into 5 horizontally as well as vertically. So you have 25 squares total in a one particular large box. So I can draw something like this. So that's what we are seeing here. So it contains almost 25 small boxes. So our idea is to understand, so what is the length of this one particular small box and what is going to be the length of this particular small box in y-axis as well. So if you again really want to put this in sort of a graph. So this is going to be the x-axis and this is going to be the y-axis. And as I told you in the beginning, so these are perfect squares. So whether it could be in the x-axis or probably whether it could be in the y-axis doesn't matter. Both will be equal. So it's going to be 1 millimeter. There's no doubt about that. But what is the variable they're going to measure is quite different. It's completely different. So that's what we know. So for example, in x-axis, what you see is the time. That's a variable that's measured in the x-axis. When you take the y-axis, it is the voltage and its amplitude of the voltage that is measured in the y-axis. So even though the length of the graph paper is the same in x-axis as well as the y-axis, what they actually measure is not the same. It's completely different. So we need to find out. So what 1 millimeter in x-axis is equivalent to and what 1 millimeter in y-axis will be equivalent to. So for that, let us have a derivation. For example, ECG machine always will show sort of calibration. So take any ECG for that matters. It's going to have something like this. So you will see something like this, which I'll show you in some time. You'll be seeing something like this. So what does that mean? So this always means a calibration, which means that particular ECG is calibrated, which means in x-axis, they are talking about a particular length. And in y-axis also, they're talking about a particular length, which is nothing but the calibration. So this is a very, very important place to look for in any ECG. So unless and until you know what and how they are calibrated, you can't really read the ECG. So let me tell you, so why? So for example, if they talk about the speed of the ECG paper, speed means how fast the ECG paper runs while the machine is recording the electrical activity. So it's approximately 25 millimeters per second. So that's the speed of the ECG paper usually. To be honest, this is something that can be changed. It's not like it's fixed, even though when you talk about the standard in India and a lot of Western countries like US or UK, it's always 25 millimeters per second. So when you take countries like Germany, for example, they run at a speed of 50 millimeters per second. In that country, 50 mm per second is considered to be a standard. For example, people, some of you, if you are preparing for German exams, you should be prepared to read the ECGs at 50 mm per second. And it's very common terminology for Germans to call it as EKG rather than ECG. They don't really call it as ECG, they call it as EKG. But nevertheless, so it differs with certain countries. But when you take India, or probably when any standard textbook you read, or probably UK, or you live in the US, doesn't matter. So the standard ECG paper running speed is approximately 25 millimeters per second. So that gives you the answer. So for example, if the ECG is running at 25, the paper is running at 25 millimeters per second, that will tell you what is this 1 millimeter equivalent to. So in x-axis, you're actually running 25 millimeter in 1 second, as simple as that. So in x-axis, you're running 25 millimeters of the paper in one single second. So that will tell you how much time it will take to run 1 millimeter. So if you want to know the time taken to run 1 millimeter of the ECG paper along the x-axis, it's just quite simple. I just need to put 1/25th of a second. So that's equivalent to approximately 0.04 of a second. So or alternately, if you're good in math, you can write it's 40 milliseconds. So why you're writing it as 40 milliseconds? Because 0.04 multiplied by 1000 will give rise to the answer called 40 milliseconds. So that's the right answer, to be honest. So I can assume that 1 millimeter in x-axis will be equivalent to either 0.04 second or alternatively 40 milliseconds. So that's the time that you need to know. It's a very, very important time, because in a lot of settings, you know, like for example, when you talk about a wide QRS or a narrow QRS, you're going to always calculate this the length only. So that's very important. So most of the time, let us take an example. For example, you have a wide QRS. So what is the definition of a wide QRS? Whenever the QRS width is going to be more than 0.12 seconds or more than 120 milliseconds, we'll be calling it as a wide QRS. But in general, when I'm looking at the ECG, I'm not going to see this. I'm going to see this. So because, you know, to have 0.12 seconds, I need to have three small boxes. So that is the length that is equivalent to 0.12 seconds. So whenever I see a QRS that is more than 0.12 seconds, which means I'm not going to see this anyway. So in the ECG paper, I'm going to see only the boxes. So if I'm going to have more than three small boxes, then I'll be calling it as wide complex QRS. So why? Because whenever you have three small boxes, that is equal to 0.12 seconds. As I told you, by the rule, whenever the QRS width is more than 0.12 seconds, or alternately, I can write whenever it is more than three small boxes, it is what we refer to as a wide QRS in the first place. So this is a very important thing. So 1 millimeter in x-axis is equal to 0.04 second or 40 milliseconds, or alternatively, three small boxes in x-axis will be equal to 0.12 seconds or 120 milliseconds, or five small boxes in x-axis will be equal to 0.2 seconds or probably 200 milliseconds, as simple as that. So now we have calibrated what's happening in the x-axis. So that's fine, that's done and dusted. So let us move on to what's going to happen in the y-axis. So how you can calibrate the y-axis. So when you want to calibrate the y-axis, so you're going to see what does this 1 millimeter in y-axis equivalent to. So 1 millimeter in y-axis will be equivalent to 0.1 millivolt. So that is the answer. So that's how it's been calibrated, because it's based on the voltage. So you need to know this number. So 1 millimeter in y-axis equivalent to 0.1 millivolt. That is the reason why whenever you see this kind of calibration in any ECG machine, so they would have given very clearly that 10 millimeter equal to 1 millivolt. That's how they were given. So this is the calibration that they would have given in any ECG paper for that matters. So 10 millimeters equal to 1 millivolt means 1 millimeter is equal to 0.1 millivolt. So let me load an ECG for you. So just to make sure that you understand this. Okay, hi, good evening, SG. Okay. Okay, see this ECG for that matter. So I have loaded an ECG for you. So this is a kind of anomaly, even though I think the clarity is not that good. So, but what I want to really tell is that you can see the calibration over here. So this is a very important part to be seen. So why this is important? If you see this calibration, they would have made this y-axis. So let me put in a red color maybe. So this y-axis, if you see, they would have made it like exactly two large boxes. So this is one large box. And inside that, you'll have multiple small boxes. We know that. So when you see this, this calibration, when you see the height of this calibration, what they have made, that will be equivalent to exactly two large boxes. What do you mean by two large boxes? So one large box in height is equal to 5 millimeter. Another large box in height is equal to 5 millimeter. So totally two large boxes will be equivalent to 10 millimeter. And you can also see this will be equivalent to one large box. One large box will be equivalent to 200 milliseconds. So this kind of calibration is very important whenever you want to look at any ECG. So before actually trying to read the ECG, first of all, see this calibration and then move to read the ECG, then only it will be easy. At least as a beginner, because sometimes if they're taken at a different speed or the different calibration, then your entire ECG reading might go wrong, because ECG is always very sensitive for certain things, especially when you want to think about some numbers. So especially when it exceeds certain cutoff, you call it as a pathology. So be sure that your calibration is right before calling it as a pathology. So that is why before starting to read an ECG, this is the place where you need to look out for, as simple as that. So now when we know what is in store with the papers, then we need to know about the leads. So how the ECG is being recorded. So that's what we're going to see. So what do you mean by the lead system and what are leads basically? And ECG, we told you the standard is always a 12 lead ECG, but it's not that. You can actually record with just 3 leads. You don't need all 12 leads to record the ECG. So 12 lead is a standard, that's all, that we commonly use in our practice. So what are the 12 leads? So how can you classify this lead system? So whenever you talk about the lead system, you're going to classify this lead system into those that have the limb leads and those that have the precordial leads. So this is how we are going to classify. So when I talk about the limb leads is again divided into two. Everyone knows that. So limb leads means, so one is the unipolar limb leads and we have the bipolar limb leads. And we have the bipolar limb leads. So what are the bipolar limb leads? Bipolar limb leads are classically 1, 2 and 3. You see in the ECG. So in the previous ECG, if you see, we have seen that leads 1, lead 2 and lead 3. So these three are the classic bipolar limb leads. I'll tell you why it is bipolar limb leads in some time when I'm going to discuss about the Einthoven's triangle. But before that, stay tuned. The bipolar limb leads are nothing but leads 1, 2 and 3. So when you talk about unipolar limb leads are also referred to as augmented limb leads because they are something sort of a derived kind of lead, which we'll be discussing in some time. There are three augmented limb leads. You have AVR, AVL and you have something called AVF. So why A? Because they are called as augmented limb leads. So they are kind of a derived limb leads. Let me describe you later on why you call this as unipolar limb leads. So these are basically the limb leads. You have only 6 limb leads and it's very difficult to increase or decrease the number of limb leads. It's actually standard and quite fixed. But precordial leads are called as flexible leads. And precordial leads are something which you can actually change even though you have 6 precordial leads from V1 to V6. It's something which can be changed. You can place even hundreds of leads on the chest if you're working in some research center and if you wanted to. But apart from that, the standard 6 chest leads are from V1 to V6. And where you will place 6 chest leads, we'll be describing in some time. But before that, how the ECG machine really records the voltage. And once you know that, we'll be knowing about, what are these leads and how they are differentiated and why they are called as unipolar and bipolar limb leads. Let us start with how the ECG machine really records a particular electrical activity. For that, you need to know the concept of depolarization. And after that, you will be needing to know the concept of something called as repolarization as well. So for example, to start with, so what do you mean by depolarization? So first, let us take a resting state. Before knowing what you mean by depolarization, let us take a resting state of a particular cell. When you take a resting state, for example, let us assume this is the outside of the cell and this is the inside of the cell. We all know that inside of the cell is relatively negative in comparison to the outside of the cell. Relatively negative in comparison to outside of the cell, that is relatively positive. Please understand, this is all relativistic terms rather than thinking like inside will be negative and outside will be positive. It's not like inside separately it is negative and outside separately it is positive. Compared to the inside, outside is positive, and compared to the outside, inside is negative. So that is how you need to take. Always have to be taken both into account. You should not take only one thing into account. Can anyone tell why the inside of the cell is relatively negative compared to the outside, and why outside of the cell is relatively positive compared to that of the inside? So can anyone tell the answer? So there are almost quite 30 odd students are there in this particular session right now. So can anyone tell us why inside is negative and outside is positive? What is the reason for that? So because there'll be a lot of undergrad students as well. So this is something that's very easily to be told. So why it is outside is positive and inside is negative? Yes, Jitesh Khandelwal has attempted an answer of potassium efflux. Yes, partly potassium efflux is right. But to be honest, if you really want to know why this is happening, because of the ionic gradient. So outside, you have a lot of positive charges. For example, sodium is an ion that is present predominantly on the outside, and potassium is an ion that is predominantly present on the inside. And this electrostatic gradient, or this electrochemical gradient of why sodium is predominantly on the outside and why potassium is predominantly on the inside, is actually maintained by a very important pump or transporter called as sodium potassium ATPase. You have 3 sodium that moves to the outside and 2 potassium that moves to the inside. Please understand, this is the pump that uses energy in the form of ATP to push the sodium to the outside and potassium to the inside. The reason is because already you have sodium more on the outside, and to put more sodium outside, you need energy. You can understand like a sort of a overhead tank. So when you open the tap from an overhead tank, it automatically flows down. So it's very simple, because the water flows down with gravity, which is a passive phenomenon. That's something that's natural and towards the gradient. But if you want to put water back into the tank, you need a motor, or you need to go up manually spending energy and you pour that water into the tank. So that's why whenever you do something against the gradient, against the natural force, so that needs energy. So that is why this pump is something that moves sodium into a place where there is already a lot of sodium, and moves potassium into a place where there is already more potassium, and that's why this utilizes energy in the form of ATP. So this pumps coupling potential. So our coupling ratio, you called as, it is 3:2, which means it pushes 3 sodium to the outside and 2 potassium to the inside. You can see that since it pushes 3 sodium to the outside and 2 potassium to the inside, you can assume that outside to be relatively positive and inside to be relatively negative. But more than that, this is a very simple way of understanding things. So why outside is positive and inside is negative? There are a lot of other things that actually maintain the resting membrane potential to be negative, and that is governed by something called as Nernst equation. You would have studied in physiology. So I don't want to really tell. So what do you mean by Nernst equation or Nernst equilibrium potential? But you have different equilibrium potential for different cations. So what do you mean by Nernst equilibrium potential, or what Nernst equation really tells you? It's very simple. So all the ions have a tendency to move across a membrane. So because a cell membrane is relatively permeable, so a lot of ions are having a tendency to move outside or move inside. For example, sodium is something, because sodium is found a lot outside in the extracellular fluid, so it has a tendency to always move into the cell. And potassium is something that has a tendency to always move outside, leak outside the cell. But if you really ask me how to prevent this sodium from coming into the cell, you need to put out something called as a positive charge. So when you put a positive charge on the membrane, this sodium being positive will get rippled out. So it won't be coming into the cell. So usually equilibrium potential of sodium will be positive. But if you take the equilibrium potential of potassium, so if you want to prevent the potassium from moving out, you need to put more negative charges inside the cell. If you put more negative charges inside the cell, these negative charges will attract potassium and make sure the potassium is kept inside the cell and it's not going to leak outside the cell. Now the question comes, so then what is the net resting membrane potential, and what is going to really contribute to the resting membrane potential of the cell? So to be honest, all the ions, including sodium, chloride, potassium, bicarbonate, calcium, all the ions actually contribute to the formation of the equilibrium potential. But if they ask you what is the one ion that is the most important thing that contributes to the formation of the resting membrane potential, it's always the potassium. Because the cell membrane's permeability to different ion is different, but the cell membrane is maximally permeable to potassium. The cell membrane has maximal permeability to potassium. So that is something like a fixed concept, like why gravity attracts things. It's like that. So cell membrane is maximally permeable to potassium. So our cell tries its best to prevent the potassium from moving outside. So as I told you, to prevent the potassium from moving outside, you need to put on more negative charges inside the cell. And that is the reason why resting membrane potential is negative. Suppose if you want to know the resting membrane potential, usually it will be approximately equivalent to equilibrium potential of the potassium, that is negative of maybe minus 60 to minus 90 millivolts for different cell, depending on the type of the cell. So that is why it's been clear that whenever you want to know which ion is the one that controls the resting membrane potential, it's always the potassium. Usually, resting membrane potential will be somewhere in and around the equilibrium membrane of equilibrium potential of the potassium, because that is the one that is maximally permeable. And that's the moment of the potassium is the one the cell wants to try and stop. And that's why the resting membrane potential is always in the negative range, almost near the equilibrium membrane potential of the potassium. So that is the concept. So why you have more negative inside, that is based on the Nernst equation and the equilibrium potential. So how to find out the resting membrane potential? Remember, resting membrane potential is actually found out using a different formula called as Goldman equation. That is different. So remember, Goldman equation is a sum of equilibrium potentials of all the ions. At the same time, it takes into consideration of the permeability to different ions as well. So Goldman equation takes the equilibrium potential of different ions. At the same time, it also takes into consideration the permeability of that particular ion as well. So Goldman equation will tell you the resting membrane potential. What is the predicted resting membrane potential of a particular cell membrane? Whereas Nernst equation will tell the equilibrium potential. I can write EX, the equilibrium potential of a particular ion. So this is the difference. So Nernst equation is going to tell the equilibrium potential of a particular ion, whereas Goldman equation is going to tell you the resting membrane potential of the cell membrane as a whole, which means Goldman equation is going to take the it can take into account the equilibrium potential of different ions. At the same time, there different permeabilities as well. So when you take everything, you get the resting membrane potential. But as a whole, as a beginner or as an undergrad, you need to know that, as I told you, this rule is very important. The resting membrane potential will always be in and around that, near that equilibrium potential of the potassium point, which is somewhere around minus 60 millivolt. So this explains you why inside of the cell is relatively negative and outside of the cell is going to be relatively positive. That explains you. Are you clear with that? So that we can move on to what do you mean by depolarization? Clear? Okay. So now we need to know what do you really mean by something called as depolarization. So what is depolarization? It is, as the name suggests, it is depolarization, which means it is destabilization of the polarity. So what is the polarity we are having already? The polarity what we are having is inside relatively negative and outside relatively positive. So you need to change that polarity. So that is what we kind of destabilization of the polarity is what we refer to as depolarization. And what do you mean by that? So you have a cell membrane, and you know that inside is negative and outside is positive. So what really happens is now the things start changing up, especially because of sodium influx. That is what is happening in the first stage of depolarization. You have studied everywhere. I'll show you the action potential curve in some time. So sodium comes inside the cell, and that's what we are going to call it as depolarization. So once the sodium comes inside, so this sodium is going to come inside. So it's going to make the inside of the cell relatively positive. So let us assume this part of the cell has become positive, and because the sodium has moved inside, outside of the cell has become relatively negative. But please understand, other parts of the cell are still not depolarized, which means other part of the cell is still maintaining its original polarity. So this is a very important concept to know. So which means the cell is actually trying to depolarize, which means that there is something called as a wave of depolarization that is actually spreading. So now in this particular direction, so you can see now the wave of depolarization is spreading, in the sense like, so initially this ion become positive, slowly, one by one, all the ions inside are becoming positive because of sodium influx, and you're actually seeing something called as a wave of depolarization that is spreading from this direction towards this direction. So in this particular situation, you can see the wave of depolarization spreading from this direction to this direction. And if you put an electrode, so let us assume this is an electrode, and if you want to record an electrical activity of what is happening right now, so what do you get? You will get a fluctuation and deviation, or you won't get a fluctuation and a deviation. That's my question. You can answer in binary, yes or no. That's all. Or you can simply write Y or no. So you will get a fluctuation or you won't get a fluctuation if you put an electrode. Come on, you can tell anything. Even you can tell no or you can tell yes, it doesn't matter. This is a very basic introductory session. So if you are wrong also, I don't really bother much. Okay, so I got a couple of answers. So you're telling it is yes. So answer is yes. You're going to get a positive deflection. That's very simple because there is a wave of depolarization that is actually passing towards the electrode, and that is going to definitely result in the development of a positive complex or a positive wave. And now let us assume, so the entire membrane has become depolarized. So now we are talking about a completed depolarization. So what do you mean by the term completed depolarization? Let us see now. So the same membrane I'm drawing here, and I'm putting the inside of the cell has become positive completely, which means it's fully depolarized, and the outside of the cell has become negative, no problem. So which means this is a place where you have got a full depolarization, which means it's a completed depolarization. The polarity has been, this is the original polarity, and this has been completely reversed now, and the outside now has become negative and the inside has become completely positive. And if you put an electrode here at this point, and if you want to record an electrical activity of what is happening here, so what do you really get here? So you get electrical waveform or you don't get an electrical waveform. Answer in binary, I need an answer in yes or no. So you do get a waveform or you don't get a waveform here. So I got one answer. Yeah, I got many answers. All of you are perfectly right, and I don't get any waveform here. So because you don't have a wave of depolarization, so only when the depolarization is happening, only during the time of depolarization, you're going to get a waveform. Once the depolarization is complete, you're not going to get the waveform. So that's the take-home point. That's really, really important. You're not going to get, so you'll get a flat line. You don't get any electrical activity or any record activity at this point at all in the first place. So that's very, very important. So, I mean, even if you completely lose the potential, once the wave has been stopped, once the progression has been stopped, so you're not going to get a waveform. So clear, that's pretty important. So we'll be discussing about the implications of that in some time. Now, let us see what you mean by repolarization. So repolarization is reversal of the destabilization that's been seen during the depolarization phase, which means reversal of destabilization of the polarity. So that is what we call repolarization, which means the cell tries to adjust its polarity back to the resting membrane potential. So what happens? So its cell tries to come to its original shape. So what does that really happen at this point? So outside now, for example, is now becoming a little positive. A few ions have become positive. And inside now they are becoming a little negative. Let us assume a part of the cell is going for depolarization. Repolarization. Not the entire cell has repolarized now. So which means the inside of the cell is still depolarized. Only a part of the cell has repolarized, and outside is still, let us assume it's negative. So which means this place has started to repolarize, and slowly this repolarization will actually continue from this direction towards this direction, which means you are actually creating something called as a wave of repolarization in this particular direction. From this direction to this direction, you are producing a wave of repolarization. My question is whether when you put an electrode at this point and you look at this particular area, now you look at this particular cell or particular area, will you get a waveform now? So tell me in binary, your answer is yes or no. Will you get a waveform or you won't get a waveform? As I told you, yes, answer is correct. So as I told you in the previous few minutes, whenever you're going to have a wave of repolarization or any wave or any progression of any change in electrical activity, so that is what is going to give rise to a particular form. Yes, you're going to get a electrical activity here. So which means this will result in a positive waveform or this will result in a negative waveform. So what it will result in? Because it's moving away from the electrode, so this will result in a positive waveform or this will result in a negative waveform. Yeah, all the people are telling negative, but slight correction with that is answer is not negative. Still, it will result in a positive deflection only. So you might be wondering why, if the deflection is moving away from a particular electrode, it's still producing a positive waveform. Because remember, repolarization is completely opposite from depolarization. So clear, here depolarization is moving in this direction, which is a different current compared to the repolarization, which is actually like 0 and 1. For example, it's like writing minus of minus 1 is equal to plus 1. So it's writing like that. So which means whenever a negative wave is moving away from a particular electrode, it will still result in something called as positive deflection only. So for example, let us assume there are a lot of positive people coming towards you, your life will become positive. Similarly, there are a lot of negative people, once they are moving away from you, your life will still become positive. So you can understand that. So that's why you are going to result in a positive deflection only. So repolarization wave moving away from a particular electrode is still going to produce a positive deflection only. So let me substantiate that in some time. So before that, so what you can deduce from this particular diagram is the fact that a repolarization is an opposite of depolarization, not only in terms of polarity, in terms of the propagation as well. For example, we saw the depolarization propagated from this direction to this direction, and the repolarization has propagated from this direction to this direction, which is completely opposite in terms of, not only in terms of polarity, in terms of direction as well. So that gives rise to your very important like electrophysiological rule, that the last place to depolarize is going to be the first place to repolarize. The last place to depolarize will be the first place to repolarize. That's a very important point. The last place to depolarize will be the first place to repolarize, and vice versa, which means the first place to depolarize will be the last place to repolarize. Clear? So now let us see what will happen in the setting of completed repolarization. So what do you mean by completed repolarization? Let us see what is that. So you have a membrane, and outside has become positive. Not a problem. Outside has become positive and inside has become negative, which means it's a sort of a completed repolarization. Now, if you put an electrode at this point and if you record the electrical activity, you will get an electrical activity or you won't get an electrical activity. Answer in binary, yes or no. You will, this electrode will record electrical activity or it will not record electrical activity. Yes, most of them are answering right. Yes, with the concept that we have seen already, you will not get electrical activity, in the sense you will get only a flat line, because there is no wave of depolarization that is actually spreading from one direction to another direction. It's actually a completed repolarization, which means the cell has completely repolarized itself. The initial destabilization of the polarity has been reversed, and the cell has reversed its polarity to the original RMP, and that is why you will not get any particular waveform in completed repolarization as well. Which means what you are trying to tell is, only during the propagation, only when the potential is changing, whenever you put a delta, it means it's changing. Whenever the potentials are changing, then only you will get a waveform. If the potentials are not changing anymore, even in full depolarization or in full repolarization, you're not going to get a waveform at all. So that's a very, very important concept. So that's what you're going to see now. So whenever you want to draw a simple ECG, so before going into the actual, details of ECG, you know very well, this is the P wave, and this is going to be due to atrial depolarization. Everyone knows that. And this QRS complex, this is the QRS complex, and this QRS complex is due to ventricular depolarization. Everyone knows that. So this is due to ventricular depolarization. And this is the T wave, and everyone knows that this is due to ventricular repolarization. And remember, usually atrial repolarization does produce a waveform, but it will not be detected in the ECG. It's very faint enough so that it will be missed in the 12-lead ECG and not be usually detected. So now you can understand. So what are these basically? So there are certain areas where you have flat lines. You don't have any waveforms at all. So there are flat lines in variety of places. So these flat lines are what we call as segments. So whenever you talk about segments, you don't really get. For example, this is what we refer to as a PR segment, where the line is flat and you don't really get any discernible waveform at that point. And this segment is what we refer to as a ST segment, and you don't get any waveform at that point. And this is what we refer to as a TP segment, or you can call it as TQ segment. If you consider only ventricular depolarization, then you can call it as TQ segment. If you take a normal ECG, then this is also called as TP segment. Whatever may be the case, this segment is also not showing any waveform and it is flat. So what does this flat lines mean? Flat lines means it's isoelectric. Isoelectric means there is neither a wave of depolarization progressing or neither a wave of depolarization is progressing. That is what it means. So which means when you take only the QRS complex, let us assume this QRS complex means this is the QRS complex and the T wave, which means QRS stands for ventricular depolarization and T wave is for ventricular repolarization. And you can clearly see, if you want to write only the ventricular activity in this particular ECG, so you have a ventricular depolarization, then followed by ventricular repolarization, which means this is a place where it happens during the depolarization, which means, let us go back to the image and show. So during this time, you are recording this complex, and that is what we called as a QRS complex. So that's what happened. So that is during repolarization. And similarly, during repolarization, as I told you, this is during repolarization, which means it moves away from this particular electrode. So even though the repolarization wave moves away from a particular electrode, we have clearly seen that it's going to produce only a positive deflection or a positive waveform. And that's why T wave is also positive in a majority of the leads. The reason is because even though you think repolarization is moving away from a particular electrode, still it is a negative wave moving away from a particular electrode. It's still going to produce a positive waveform only. So this is the waveform that happens during repolarization. So this is the waveform that's going to happen during repolarization. But what happens in between? So in between, this is the time where the ventricle is in completed depolarization phase. So when the ventricle is completely depolarized, you are not going to get any waveform, as I told you. And this is the place, this is a TQ segment, or probably you can call it a TP segment, whatever may be the fact. So this is a TQ segment. So this is the place where the ventricle is in completed repolarization phase. So that's the reason why you're not getting any waveform in this particular perspective. Because when we are discussing advanced concepts, like why you have ST segment elevation, why you have ST segment depression, so you need to know this. So which means in completed depolarization, completed repolarization phase, you're not going to result in any discernible waveform, and the electrical activity will be silent and zero. And that's where you're going to get this isoelectric segments like ST segment and TP segment. Clear? So do you understand why you get these waveforms and why you get these segments in the first place right now? So that we can move on to the next set of discussions. Clear? Okay. Cool. Now we have discussed a variety of concepts. So, all right. So now we need to come back to our original discussion on why we have this lead system. And first of all, we need to answer the question. So why you need these two different sets of lead systems? So why you have something called as a limb lead, and you also have something called as chest lead, and why you need this two different set of lead systems. So remember, heart is basically a three-dimensional structure. So we know that anything in the body or anything in the universe has three dimensions, apart from certain things like a flat paper. If you see at microscopic level, in a paper has three dimensions, but at a macroscopic level, paper is something that has two dimensions. But anything apart from that, you see a chair or a human body or a bottle or anything you see, it's going to have three dimensions. So heart is also an organ which has three dimensions. So it has three different planes, and you need to find out the electrical activity from different planes. Then only you can find the electrical, that will cover the electrical activity of the entire heart. For example, when you put a limb lead, so limb leads are placed here. So when you place limb leads, so they are really going to record the electrical activity from this particular plane, like that you can cut the heart from this axis. Once you cut the heart from this axis, this you can call it as a coronal plane, but it's not really coronal plane. We can call it as a frontal plane from ECG's perspective. And when you cut the heart from this plane, because this leads are recording the electrical activity from the limbs at this particular plane. So this are also called as frontal plane axis or frontal leads. So which means limb leads are the ones that are going to record the electrical activity from the frontal plane using the limbs, which will be more clear when I'm going to put the diagram and I'm going to discuss about the Einthoven's principle in some time, maybe in a couple of minutes. When you talk about chest leads, are the ones that are put like this, which means they are going to see the electrical activity by cutting the heart at this particular plane, in the sense like you're cutting the heart at an axial plane. So this is what we refer to as, in ECG terms, we call it as a horizontal plane axis. So which means you have two sets of leads. One is the limb leads, and second is the chest leads. Limb leads see the electrical activity at this plane, and the chest leads see the electrical activity at this plane. So they are seeing the heart from two different planes, so that you can deduce the electrical activity in three dimensions of what is happening. So this is what we call it as a frontal plane axis, and then we call it as a horizontal plane axis. So whenever you talk about a frontal plane axis, means they're talking about limb leads. Whenever you talk about a horizontal plane axis, means they're talking about the precordial leads. Precordial leads are also referred to as something called as chest leads. Clear? As simple as that. So now going into the Einthoven's principle and the limb lead. So what really Einthoven did, and remember, first of all, if you want to know about the father of ECG, so this is a very important name. So you know who's that? We are talking about him for a long time. So his name is Wilhelm Einthoven. Willem Einthoven is the one who is considered as the father. Like that, we have many fathers. We have discussed, like, father of EEG is something called as Dr. Hans Berger. And the father of stethoscope is René Lennec. He's a French physician. Father of mercury sphygmomanometer is something called as Riva Rossi. He's an Italian physician. And father of diastolic blood pressure. Somebody found out how the diastolic blood pressure can be measured. His name is called as Ivan Kortkov, who's a Russian physician. And we also have the father of systolic blood pressure, palpatory method of how you find out the blood pressure is done by someone called as Karl Potting. Clear? So you have different names that you need to know. So systolic, palpatory method of BP, Karl Potting, diastolic, auscultatory method of BP by Ivan Kortkov, that's why we name it as Kortkov sounds, and the stethoscope by René Lennec, and BP apparatus, mercury sphygmomanometer by Riva Rossi, and EEG by Dr. Hans Berger, and ECG by Dr. Willem Einthoven. So Willem Einthoven is considered the father of the EC because he's the one who first attempted and succeeded in recording the electrical activity of the heart. And this rule called as Einthoven's rule is something that is used even now in modern practice, which is very, very helpful for us. Let us see what he really did. So let us take a human. So for example, I'm going to draw a human here. I mean, even though it's not very symmetric, sorry for that, but still, this will give you a good insight. Okay. So you have the right arm and you have the left arm here, and you have the right leg and you have the left leg, or the right lower limb or the left lower limb. So where are the leads placed? The leads are placed in all the limbs, in fact. So you have the leads that are placed in the right arm, you have leads that are placed in the left arm, and leads that are placed in the left leg. As well, you have leads that are placed in the right leg as well. For time being, I'm going to ignore the lead that is placed in the right leg because it is considered to be neutral. Neutral will always be green. How can you understand which is neutral? Neutral will be green in color. You can really see in your ECG lab. When you go to the hospital, see the ECG machine, the neutral will be green in color that is placed on the right leg. So remember, whenever you want to measure electrical activity, you need to have a neutral. The same applies for nerve conduction studies as well. The same applies for your routine day-to-day electrical current that you see, all the electrical box that you see, there will always be a neutral. So then only you can find out the difference in the potentials between them. That's why you need to have a neutral. Right leg, green color lead, it will be neutral. So that is very, very important. Right arm lead will be usually black in color, I mean white in color, and left leg will be usually black in color, and left leg usually will be red in color. Very, very important. And this is a universal standard, even though it is different with different countries. Again, remember, right arm will be white in color, left arm will be black in color, and left leg usually will be red in color. As I told you, the neutral will always be green in color. So why they have given color coding? Because you don't misplace the leads and measure wrong potentials from different leads. That's why they have given the color coding here. Right arm white, left arm black, left leg red and right leg green. Remember, for time being, we are going to ignore the right leg for now because that is a neutral. We don't want to confuse ourselves with that. So now, so what Einthoven did, for example, you have a potential that is really moving from right arm towards the left arm. We know that. So if you consider right arm to be negative and left arm to be positive, so you don't do that. The machine will do that. Don't worry about it. So the machine will imagine that right arm to be negative and right arm to be negative and left arm to be positive. So you can really see there will be a potential that is moving from right arm towards the left arm. And they call this as something called as a lead one. So this is how they call it as. And next, the machine will imagine that the right arm to be negative and the left leg to be positive. And you can see there is a potential difference that's happening between the right arm and the left leg. And you can see there is an electrical activity that is moving because it's negative and positive. And remember, you can ask why it is negative and why it is positive and how the potential is moving. Remember, actually, your potential is distributed throughout the body. It means the body is a very good conductor of electricity. We know that because body has something called 60% of water. And because it has 60 to 70% of water, it is an excellent conductor of electricity. So whatever electrical potential that is generated by the heart is spread throughout the body. It's just that we need to understand this negative and this is positive. And of course, there will be a difference in potential that is created and that can be recorded. And that is the basis of finding out an electrocardiogram, to be honest. So the machine assume that right arm to be negative and left leg to be positive. And you can see there is a potential difference that's created between right arm and left leg. And they call this to be lead two. And now the machine will assume the left arm to be negative and left leg to be positive. And you can see there is a potential difference that is created. And the electrical current will move from the left arm towards the left leg. And this is what he named as something called as lead 3. So this is the classic Einthoven's triangle, even though it is not symmetric by the looks of it. But Einthoven described with a lot of theorems and a lot of mathematical calculation that this triangle is symmetric, what you have drawn. So you have drawn some Ironman kind of a triangle here. So this triangle is basically symmetric in nature. And I've given an Einthoven's rule as well, which we'll be discussing about sometime. And these are what we refer to as the famous bipolar limblets. So why we call it as a bipolar limblets? Because if you see this lead, it starts from negative and it goes towards positive. Every lead, if you take lead 1 or lead 2 or lead 3, if you take, it starts from negative and it goes towards positive. So that is why these are called as bipolar limblets, because it starts from negative and goes towards positive. Then what about the unipolar limblets? For that, we need to go a little better on. So I told you this will be the lead 1, this will be the lead 2, and this will be the lead 3. So I can alternatively rub and write from right arm towards the left arm is going to be the lead 1. And from the left arm towards the left leg is going to be the lead 3. And from the right arm towards the left leg is going to be the lead 2. So which I have discussed already, this is the derivation that you have made already. So that's why I'm just extrapolating this. And we know the classic 3 bipolar limblets. Now there are some derived leads. How you derive that? So now you take a midpoint. So midpoint here. So which means here it is negative, here it is positive. In this particular lead, we know that. And if you take a midpoint, so which means you are taking the halfway mark. So by assumption, if one end is negative and the other end is positive, the halfway mark always should be zero. We know that. And you know very well that if you take this zero mark, and now if you assume that this leg to be positive, and you can see now there is an electrical potential difference that is created, and now the current will be moving towards the leg from that zero point which you have marked. So this is zero point that you have marked, and assume this to be positive now. And now you can see the current is moving from the zero point that we have measured and towards the left leg. And this is a kind of a derivation that the machine is going to do. And this is what we refer to as augmented limblet of foot, or otherwise referred to as AVF. So it's a kind of a derivative. It's not an original Einthoven's leads. It's a bipolar lead. It's kind of a unipolar lead. So why it's called a unipolar lead? Now the electrical current is not moving from a negative to positive. If it's moving from negative to positive, you can call it as a bipolar limblet. So because it's going from zero to positive, it's not bipolar anymore. It's going to be a unipolar limblet. So that's why AVF is supposed to be a unipolar limblet and not a bipolar limblet. And apart from that, similarly, you can do other derivations also. If you take something called as lead 3 divided by 2, which means you are taking a halfway mark between the left arm and the left leg, you take the halfway mark. You know that lead 3 is actually formed by left arm and left leg. Left arm is assumed to be negative and left leg is assumed to be positive. That's why you create a lead 3. And if you see the halfway mark there, and this has to be the zero point. And from here, if you consider right arm to be positive, and the machine is going to do that assumption, and if you put a potential difference and the electrical activity is going to go towards the right arm here from a zero point towards a positive right arm, and this is what we refer to as something called as AVR, augmented limb lead of the right arm. And now you can also assume that lead 2, similarly you have assumed lead 1 halfway mark and lead 3 halfway mark. Now let us assume the lead 2 halfway mark as well, so which must be the zero point as per the assumptions we have made already. And if the machine assumes the left arm to be positive now, and you can see the potential difference is created between the zero point and the left arm, and the electrical activity is moving towards the left arm now from a zero point, and this is what we refer to as AVL, or augmented limb lead that is going towards the left arm. It's a kind of a derived lead from the zero point. Since all these three leads which I've told you are actually starting from a zero point and going towards the positive point and not from a negative to positive, and that's why these leads are basically called as something called as unipolar limb leads and not bipolar limb leads. And you can see the central point where all the augmented leads meet at this point. So which means all the zeros are actually all the zeros. If you see, this is a zero, this is a zero, and this is zero. All the zeros meet at this point, and this point is a big zero again, and that's what we refer to as a Wilson's central terminus. Wilson's central terminus, and this is in complete concordance with the vector principles and the routine algebra that we use, because we don't want to go into the details of the vector principles and the mathematics right now, but still, this is a brain of I'm the One, and this is a complete, you know, like correlation with the usual vector principles that we use in algebra. So this is, there is no violation there. That's why I'm the One's brain has been thought to be like one of the biggest during that time. So that's what we call it as a Wilczek zero point. Or you can assume it starts from this area to this area as well. Everything will be correct. Your assumption is right. So you have why AVR is negative. Let us come back to that. So Prabhakar Ishwar is asking why AVR is negative. We'll come back to that in some time. So why AVR is negative? That is based on the axis. So you're talking about the axis, not just the polarity of this leads. So that is different. So now you know where the leads are placed. So now you know what are the limb leads. So now you have both the unipolar as well as the bipolar leads. So you have, what you know what you mean by 1, 2, 3. You know what you mean by AVL, AVR and AVF. With this, let us put the axis, the frontal plane axis, what these leads are trying to find out. So for that, I need to put out a circle first and a variety of leads as well. So let us see what they really do. So I'm going to put some series of lines here. I'm going to put a series of lines like this here, and I'm going to put some dotted lines as well. I mean, just to complete the circle, I'm putting some dotted lines also here. That's all. So, but these are the leads we're talking about. So these are the lead one and lead two and lead three. So these are the three classic bipolar leads that are originally described by I'm the One. So if you take, let us take this circle. So when you take this circle's perspective, this lead one is the one that is at 0 degree, and this arbitrary line. So there is no lead here. Please understand, there's no lead here. This is an arbitrary line which you can tell it is at 180 degree. So anything that is quite opposite to each other is what we call as at 180 degrees apart. So when it is perpendicular to each other, we call it as 90 degrees, right? So this is the point where you have 90 degrees. So this is perpendicular to each other. But when you have it in the clockwise direction, so this is the clockwise direction that we have. So when you have it in the clockwise direction, we give by the designation positive. So that's why we call it as a positive 90 degree. So it's nothing to do with the polarity of the leads, which I have described in the I'm the One's rule. It's just with the going by the clockwise and the anti-clockwise direction of the circle. So we call it to be 90 degree. And this can be assumed as minus 90 degree because it's in the anti-clockwise direction. That is minus 90 degree. And lead two is assumed to be at plus 60 degree position. And that is again a very, very completely relevant mathematical derivation. And lead three is at plus 120 degree. And this is the lead AVL and this is the lead AVR. And lead AVL, you can see it's an anti-clockwise direction. So that is why it is supposed to be at minus 30 degree. And lead AVR is again at anti-clockwise direction. So that is the reason why lead AVR, you can assume it to be somewhere on minus 150 degree. So these are the arrangement of the leads in the frontal plane axis. So what these leads are basically seeing, you can see if you imagine this heart as a circle, and they're trying to read the electrical activity from different parts of the heart. So lead one is seeing the heart from this particular perspective, and lead AVL is seeing the heart from this particular perspective, and lead two is seeing the heart from this particular perspective, and lead three is seeing the heart from this particular perspective, and lead AVR is seeing the heart from this particular perspective, which means it's all about how the leads are seeing the heart from different perspectives. So which means you can see all the leads are spread out like a spider web like this, you can see that, and which means they are seeing the heart from a frontal plane axis. So this is the plane that they are seeing. So that is why these leads are referred to as frontal plane axis. So they are the ones that are going to tell the frontal plane axis. So when you read this itself, you need to understand what you mean by the axis. So whenever we talk about axis in regards to the heart, we are actually trying to talk about the frontal plane axis. We don't really consider the horizontal plane axis, even though horizontal plane axis is important when you wanted to read the ECG in advanced way. But whenever you talk about simple axis, they always mean a frontal plane axis. That's what it means. So you would have studied. So there is something called as a left axis deviation. There is something called as a right axis deviation. There is something called as a extreme axis deviation. All these things you would have studied in textbooks. So how they define? So arbitrarily, it is defined as, you know, like all these definitions are actually based on principles and statistics that's been taken from the general population. So what they have given is, So when you take the leads again, so you know what are these leads? I don't want to draw again. I don't draw these leads again. So this is lead one, and this is lead two, and this is lead three, and this is lead AVR, and this is lead AVR. We know that. So there is no lead here. So it's just arbitrary line. This is just an arbitrary line. There's no lead here. Suppose if somebody asks you, how will you define a normal axis? So there are multiple different definitions of a normal axis. But if somebody asks you, what do you mean by a normal axis? If you share this area. So this is what we define as a normal axis. So which means you can tell me what is normal axis. So when you talk about a normal axis in the electrocardiogram, it means it's somewhere around, you know, from AVL to this particular area. So this particular area is AVF, right? It's not an arbitrary line. So sorry for that. It's AVF, which is at plus 90 degree. Clear? So if you want to know, so from where to where your normal axis extends, from AVL to AVF is the position where your normal axis extends from. So if you want to tell mathematically, I can tell from minus 30 degree to plus 90 degree. So this is where the normal axis extends from. But if you see certain textbooks like Harrison, sometimes in certain areas in Harrison, they would have given minus 30 to plus 110 degree, which is also correct. Again, it depends on the different principles. If your author is from Europe, they will tell minus 30 to plus 110. If your author is from US, they will tell from minus 30 to plus 90 degree. Doesn't matter. So you can keep this as a standard. So minus 30 to plus 90 degree is the normal axis. So if they ask you, when will you call this a right axis? If the net electrical vector or the net electrical activity of the heart is in this particular region. If the net electrical activity of the heart is in this particular region, which means from AVF to this 180 degree point. So that is what we called as a right axis. So which means this is where you called as a right axis deviation. If the net electrical activity of the heart is located in this particular direction. So from in the blue shaded area, that is what you call as right axis deviation. So which means it's from plus 90 degree to 180 degree. So 180 is, there is no minus or more plus. 180 means it's 180, 0 means it's 0. You cannot tell minus 0 or plus 0. Similarly, in geometry, there is no minus 180 or plus 180. So 0 cannot be minus 0 or plus 0. Similarly, in geometry, there cannot be minus 80 or plus 180. It is always 180 degree only. So clear? So from 90 degree to 180 degree, if you see the axis, then it is what we refer to as something called as a right axis. Then what about left axis? So if the net electrical activity of the heart is located in this particular axis, in this particular area, which I've shared in yellow, this is what we refer to as a left axis or a left axis deviation. If the net electrical activity is located in that particular area. So what do you mean by left axis? So you know AVL is at minus 30 degree. So if the axis of the heart is from minus 30 degree to minus 90 degree, we know this line is at minus 90 degree. So if your axis of the heart is located in this particular region, so then we call it as a left axis deviation. Then finally comes this particular left out quadrant. Usually finding the electrical activity of the heart in this particular region is extremely rare. Suppose if you are finding out electrical activity in this particular quadrant, it is what we refer to as something called as a extreme axis deviation, or always referred to as a northwest axis deviation. So which is actually from minus 90 degree to 180 degree. So if you find the electrical activity of the heart in this particular region, it's actually extreme as we tell. It's not usually common. Very few conditions will produce the electrical activity of the heart to be in that particular direction. So that's an extreme axis from minus 90 to 180 degrees. So this is the definitions that we need to know about different distribution of axis in the heart. If you understand this, then let us see how you find out the net electrical activity of the heart. So do you understand this? So different shadings which are made. Okay, cool. So now we have not really seen what do you mean by Einthoven's rule. So what do you mean by Einthoven's rule? So what do you really mean by Einthoven's rule? I mean, it has a lot of mathematical derivations that are involved with it. But Einthoven's rule clearly tells that 1 plus 3 is equal to 2. So you might be wondering, what is this? But Einthoven really proved that. So in the bipolar leads, 1 plus 3 will be equal to 2. Or probably 1 plus 3 minus 2 is equal to 0. So these two derivations are very, very important, very commonly asked in exams. Einthoven's rule. You can still see this in your routine ECG, irrespective of how the ECG is taken. So this rule will be satisfied. So let us see whether this rule will be satisfied or not. Let us see that. So let me show you that. Just hold on. Okay, I've uploaded an image here, the same image only, but I think it will be in a good clarity now. So let us apply the Einthoven's rule and see whether it works or not. So I told you 1 plus 3 will be equal to 2, or 1 plus 2 plus 3, or when you add all the three leads, it will be equal to 0. If you 1 plus 3 minus 2 will be equal to 0. So let us see the first rule. So first rule tells 1 plus 3 equal to 2. So this is the first rule we are talking about. So which means you are going to calculate all the electrical potentials in lead 1 and lead 2. If you see lead 1, so you can see lead 1. Let us take the QRS complex alone for simplicity. So lead 1 tells like you have maybe some three small boxes here and 5 small boxes here and another 4. So let us take as an average, you have 3 small boxes, 5 small boxes in one large box and another 4 small boxes here. You can see here 3 plus 5 plus 4 is approximately 12. So that's what is seen here. And if you see the lead 3 here, you have 2 small boxes and then you have approximately 5, maybe here another one. So 5 plus 2 plus 1, approximately you have around 8 small boxes here. So now you see 12 plus 8 is equal to 20, right? So yeah, 12 plus 8 is equal to 20. If you see here, so you can see the negative deflection here. So this is 1. Then you have the positive deflections here. You have 5, 5, and 5, and 3. So if you take 18, approximately you have 20 small boxes here. So which means 12 plus 8 is equal to 20. So which means when you add 1 and 3, it will be equal to 2. So that is very, very important. Similarly, as per the second rule of Einthoven, 1 plus 3 minus 2 is equal to 0. If you see here, 1 is 12 plus 3 is 8 minus 20 will be equal to 0. So and that rule is satisfied again. So if you take approximately, but if you calculate very minutely, it will be 100% correct. So even if you take any ECG and if you calculate this approximately, this rule will be satisfied. So what are the Einthoven's rule as we discussed already? So 1 plus 3 is equal to 2 and 1 plus 3 minus 2 will be equal to 0. And this is a very, very important rule and many times you can have this in your exam. So that's what we call it as an Einthoven's rule. And now how to find out the frontal plane axis. So that is what is very important. Now we know the definitions of different axes. Now we know that what is called as a normal axis, what is called as a right axis, what is called as a left axis, what is called as an extreme axis. Now we know all the things, but how will you find out where the electrical activity of the heart is located at? So, and how will you find out the frontal plane axis? How will you know that the net electrical activity is located in this area, or net electrical activity is located in this area, or the net electrical activity is located in this area, or the net electrical activity is located in this area? How will you know that? So for that, we need to know one important principle called 90 degree rule or 90 degree principle. So let me tell you what you mean by 90 degree principle. So let me draw a line first. So let us assume you have a recording electrode at this point. So recording electrode at this point. So this is negative and this is positive. Usually positive is considered to be the recording electrode. And let us assume now a wave of depolarization is actually moving in this particular direction, so from negative towards positive, and it is straight in line with the with the recording electrode, which means it goes at 0 degree. What do you mean by 0 degree? When there is no angle difference at all, it goes straight on and hits that particular head-on end collision, which means it happens at 0 degree. When you come and hit at this point, it will be some probably like 30 or 60 degree. When it comes and hits at that point, it's perpendicular, 90 degree. When you come and hit on the back, it's a reverse 180 degree hit. So this is how we define the hits. Let us assume for time being, you have a hit at 0 degree, which means the depolarization wave is in straight on line and hits the recording electrode with no angle and straight head on collision with the recording electrode, 0 degree. So if the depolarization wave goes in line with the recording electrode, which means towards the recording electrode, so wave of depolarization passing towards the recording electrode, you get a positive deflection or get a negative deflection. The answer is from the audience. So you're going to get a positive deflection or negative deflection as per a previous rule. It's very, very simple. So typically you're going to get something called the positive deflection. So what do you mean by that? You're going to get a full on positive deflection, which means it will be full positive. So that's very, very important. It'll be full positive. Clear? Let us see another example. It's an easy one again. So let us see another one. So this rule is very, very important if you want to know if you want to find out the axis. It might be looking very simple and stupid right now, but this is the one that's going to help you understand how to find out the net electrical axis. So now let us assume this is the recording electrode and this is negative and this is positive as usual. But now let us assume, remember I'm talking about a depolarization wave. Now let us assume it is actually moving exactly opposite direction, which means it's going at 180 degree from the recording electrode. So in comparison to the recording electrode, this waveform is moving exactly in opposite direction. This is a depolarization wave moving in the exact opposite direction. So now this recording electrode will definitely, because it's a wave that's moving, so definitely it will record a record a potential, and this potential will be negative or positive. Now the onus is for the audience to take over. So it will be negative or a positive deflection. Of course, it's a depolarization wave moving away from a recording electrode. Definitely will result in the development of a negative deflection. So you are going to get a full negative deflection. Okay? So you're going to get a full negative deflection. As simple as that. Now let us see the third example. Now I'm going to put a third example where you have the negative, positive here, and you have the recording electrode here. This is the recording electrode. Now let us assume there is a depolarization wave that is hitting at an angle. For example, let us assume there is a wave of depolarization that is actually going in this particular direction. So you have depolarization direction, which means it's creating an angle with the recording electrode. It is not just hitting straight on or going away, it's creating an angle now. So this is the wave of depolarization here that is actually creating an angle here. So which means, for example, let us assume this could be a probably 60 degree angle it's creating. Whenever something creates an angle, so you need to put a vector. So I mean, always you need to put a vector, which means the force will be distributed depending on how it is colliding. So when it is a head-on collision, 100% it is hitting on straight. So but whenever you hit from the side, not all the energy is transferred to the particular. For example, if someone comes and hits from the side, only your side of your car may be damaged. When somebody comes and hits straight, it means all the energy is actually transferred into your car. So that's 100% conversion. But here, whenever you hit from the side, so you distribute the energy. So which means you can see, since it's creating more angle, which means it's more towards the recording electrode, you can draw the vector to be more towards this side and a little distributed away from this recording electrode also, which means the depolarization wave is producing more force towards the recording electrode and a little force away from the recording electrode. Which means, what do you mean by that? So what the recording electrode will show? Recording electrode will be showing a positive deflection or negative deflection in this particular example. Yes, it will be showing positive deflection. It will be showing negative deflection also, but it will be predominantly positive deflection. In the sense, like, it will be predominantly positive and a little negative. So this is how the deflection is going to be, because when you go towards this side, that's why it is angled towards this side. So if it's angled towards this side, means there is a lot of vectors that are moving towards the recording electrode and little vector is moving away from the recording electrode as well. That is why it is slanted towards this side. Otherwise, if this is more powerful, you would have slanted towards this side. So that's how you have to imagine, and that's why it will show a big positive deflection and a small negative deflection. But nevertheless, you have a predominantly positive deflection. That's what we're going to get here. That's the take-home message. And now let us see a fourth example. You will understand much better. So now you have a negative and a positive, and this is the recording electrode. Positive is what we refer to as recording electrode. And now you have a wave of depolarization. Now it is moving in this particular direction. Let us assume. So now the wave of depolarization is moving in this particular direction. Now you can see, when you compare with the recording electrode, now it is creating a huge angle. The angle is more than 90 degree. Here if you see, the angle is less than 90 degree. Here if you see, the angle is actually more than 90 degree. It's creating a kind of an obtuse angle. Whenever it's less than 90, we call it as acute angle. When it's more than 90, we call it as an obtuse angle. It's creating more of an obtuse angle. Now you can see the vector spread. Little is towards this side, but predominantly it is towards this side, that is opposite from the recording electrode, which means that's why it is slanted towards this side. If this direction is more, means it should have slanted towards this side, but that's not happening. So it's slanted towards that side, means you have a lesser potential force towards that side and more force towards that side. So that's why it's slanted towards that particular side. So now what will be the deflection? You will get both positive and negative, but which will be predominant? It will be predominantly negative or predominantly positive? Yes, correct, Dr. Jeeva. You know, like, answer is predominantly negative and a little positive, which means it still produces a positive and negative, but it produces a predominantly negative deflection. So now let us see the final one. This is the final situation. So once again, this is negative, this is positive, and this is the recording electrode over here. And now I am telling that my depolarization wave is sitting perpendicular at exactly 90 degree. It's sitting, which means there is an equal distribution of vectors on either side. So which when you hit perpendicularly, there will be equal distribution on either side. That's how the force is diverted to each other. So now in this particular example, you will see a positive deflection, negative deflection, or both positive and negative with equal intensities. What you will see here? What you will see here basically? You will see both positive and negative, or only positive or only negative, or predominantly positive or predominantly negative. What you will see here? So here, as I told you, there is equal distribution of the vectors towards this recording electrode and equal distribution away from the recording electrode as well. So now you are going to get a positive deflection as well as a negative deflection, but it will be equal in nature. So the amplitude will be equal, and this kind of deflections is what we refer to as a biphasic deflection. This is what we refer to as something called the biphasic deflection. Now let us take the beginning and the end. So let us start from here and let us end. So remember, if the depolarization wave forms an angle of 0 degrees straight in line with the recording electrode, it's going to get produce a full positive deflection. If the depolarization wave is completely against the recording electrode, it moves completely opposite the recording electrode, it's going to produce a full negative deflection. The depolarization wave is going to create an acute angle that is less than 90 degree with the recording electrode, it's going to, the depolarization wave is going to produce an obtuse angle with the recording electrode, it's going to produce a predominantly negative deflection. And the depolarization wave is going to produce an exact 90 degree with the recording electrode, then it's going to produce a biphasic deflection or an equal deflection with each other. So clear? So this is the final take home point. So 0 degree, full positive, 180 degree, full negative, acute angle less than 90 degree, predominantly positive, obtuse angle more than 90 degree, predominantly negative, exactly perpendicular to the recording electrode, it's going to produce a biphasic deflection. So this is a very, very important rule to understand. So where the axis is and how to deduce that. So let us see now. So to find out the frontal plane axis, so now I'm going to write an answer called how to find a frontal plane axis. How to find out a frontal plane axis. That's what I'm going to find out. So how to do that? So you need to have something called as a quadrant rule. So what, I mean, there are many principles to find out a frontal plane axis. So remember, whenever you call the term axis, it always means a frontal plane axis when it comes to the ECG. So we are going to follow something called as a quadrant rule. So that's what I'm going to follow. So how to use this quadrant rule? So it's very simple. So for example, I'm going to put the 90 degree rule and I'm going to assume something. Then I'm going to derive it. So first let us see my assumption first. So what is my assumption now? So my assumption is, so this is the quadrant. So let us assume this is lead one, this is lead ABF. I'm going to take only two leads, lead one, lead ABF, nothing else. Later on, I'll be incorporating lead two also. Now let us assume only lead one, lead ABF is there. Now I'm assuming that my net electrical activity of the heart is in this particular direction, or probably in this particular quadrant. If I assume my axis, for example, I mean, don't want to shade here, rather than I will tell you, I'm assuming my net electrical vector is in this particular quadrant. I mean, it's in this direction. So now you need to tell, if this is going to be the recording electrode, what is the angle that is created between the net electrical vector and the recording electrode? It is less than 90 degree or more than 90 degree? You are going to answer. So answer fast. Less than 90 or more than 90? What is the angle that is created? Angle created, if you take this as a recording electrode, and if you assume the blue color line is an assumption, if you assume that the net electrical activity is in that particular direction, now you can see the difference in angle between the lead one and the net electrical activity is the less than 90 degree. So lead one will, in this particular example, will be positive or negative? Lead one in this particular example will be positive or negative? Lead one will be positive. So lead one is going to be positive in this particular example for sure, because it's creating an angle less than 90 degree. Okay. Now same example, I mean, same, let us assume the electrical vector in that particular direction only. Now you can see, if you take this as a recording electrode now, and what is the angle that is created between the net electrical axis and the recording electrode? It's less than 90 or more than 90 in this particular example? Not less than 90 or more than 90. So what's your take? You have ABF, and the net arterial axis. I'll come back to that because, I mean, Naveen is asking about the P wave concept, but that's I will come back to that in P wave later on. So let us finish off the QRS complex first, because the ventricle and the atrium are located completely differently, and the angle that is created by the atrium and the ventricle is totally different. Now it's less than 90 or more than 90. We know it's less than 90. So if it's going to be less than 90, then definitely, you know, AVF also is going to produce a positive deflection. So correct. So that's going to produce a positive deflection here. So now you know that not only this, if your net electrical axis is anywhere in this particular quadrant, between 1 and AVF, if your net electrical axis is located, or net cardiac vector is located, your 1 is going to be positive and AVF is going to be positive. So now you have made a derivation, you have made a mathematical calculation. Suppose if your vector is present in this quadrant, if your net cardiac activity is present in this quadrant, 1 is also going to be positive and AVF is also going to be positive. So I'm going to tell you what this, I'm going to ask you what this quadrant belongs to. This quadrant, this pi belongs to what axis? It belongs to a normal axis or a left axis or a right axis or an extreme axis. So this quadrant belongs to a normal axis. So that pi, what we've seen, is belonging to a normal axis. So I can assume that whenever 1 is positive, AVF is positive, I know very well my net cardiac activity should be, my net cardiac vector should be in that particular quadrant only. That particular quadrant belongs to the normal axis. So I can clearly tell if 1 is positive, AVF is positive, it belongs to the normal axis. As simple as that. 1 positive, AVF also positive means definitely my cardiac vector should be in this particular quadrant only. Since that quadrant belongs to the normal axis, I can clearly write that is a normal axis, by the way. So that is concept number one. And let us see another similar concepts. So now let us assume my net electrical vector or net cardiac activity or net cardiac electrical activity is in that particular direction. So again, by using our simple rule, 1 AVF and 90 degree rule, I can write, so suppose if I take 1 as a recording electrode now, so what is the angle that is generated between 1 and the electrical activity? Now it is less than 90 or more than 90. And what sort of deflection it will create? Negative deflection or positive deflection in lead 1? So take lead 1 as a recording electrode. So what is the assumption? So definitely the angle between lead 1 and the net electrical activity in this particular example is more than 90 degrees. So you will get a negative deflection. Clear? Similarly, on the other hand, if you take AVF as a recording electrode, if you deduce that AVF to be a recording electrode, then you can see what is the angle here. What is the angle here that is created? Less than 90 or more than 90. So AVF should be positive or negative? Okay. So it's less than 90 degree. So AVF should be positive here. So now I'll be clearly knowing. So if 1 is negative and if AVF is positive, definitely, you know, like your cardiac vector should be somewhere in this particular quadrant only. So only if your net cardiac vector is present in that particular quadrant, you will get this kind of a combination, 1 negative, AVF positive. So I can indirectly also tell if in the ECG, if 1 is negative and AVF is positive, the cardiac vector should be in this particular quadrant only. There is no other option. So this quadrant belongs to what axis? So if you see the pi diagram, which I've shown, this quadrant belongs to what axis? This quadrant belongs to right axis. So now I can tell this, if 1 is negative and AVF is positive, that belongs to a right axis, and I can talk about right axis deviation. So this is how you find out right axis deviation. Similarly, alternatively, let us see other derivations also. Now let us assume my net cardiac vector is in this particular direction. So same lead 1 AVF concept. So I'm going to see only these two, lead 1 and AVF. So now if you see the angle difference between lead 1 and this electrical activity, if you assume that cardiac vector is in that particular quadrant or in that particular area, so what is the angle difference between lead 1 and the electrical activity, yeah, electrical vector? Less than 90 or more than 90? Yeah, definitely it's more than 90. So lead 1 should be showing a negative deflection if your electrical vector is present in that particular quadrant. Similarly, what is the angle difference between AVF and lead 1? I mean, that particular electrical activity, cardiac vector, more than 90 or less than 90? So once again, it will be more than 90. So lead AVF also will show negative deflection. So clear? So which means whenever I find a lead one to be negative and lead AVF also to be predominantly negative, now I can assume that there is no other option. The electrical activity should be located in this particular quadrant only. So only when the net cardiac vector is present in that quadrant, you will get this combination of lead one is also negative and lead AVF is also negative. And coupled with that, there will be one important finding. If the electrical activity is in that particular axis, that your AVR is usually located, it's an extreme lead that is located in that particular direction. So AVR usually will be positive. So whenever you see this combination, along with this combination, if you see AVR also to be positive, it's very clear that my net cardiac vector should be located in this particular pie diagram, in particular area in the pie diagram. So what this area belongs to in your diagram, which I've shown you. It suggests you that the patient is having an extreme axis deviation. So this is a northwest axis, or otherwise referred to as extreme axis deviation. One negative, AVF negative. Along with that, if your AVR is full positive, it's 100% sure that you're dealing with the northwest axis. It's very, very rare to have this combination. Extremely rare to have this combination. Now, let me tell you the final thing. So final thing is a little confusing for you, many of the people, in fact. So this is one, this is AVF. But the quadrant is something you can easily deduce. So let us assume this is the direction of the electrical activity in that particular, the particular patient. So now you see the assuming that electrical activity, net cardiac vector is passing through that particular quadrant. Now, what will be the deflection in one? What will be the deflection in AVF? So what is the angle that is created? If one is a recording electrode, what is the angle created between one and the net cardiac vector? Less than 90 or more than 90, it will be positive or it will be negative. Angle difference between the one and the cardiac vector is less than 90, so it will be positive. Clear, one will be positive. Okay, Naveen is telling negative less than 90. No. It's still, it's within the 90 degree zone. So whenever it is within the 90 degree zone, it will be causing a positive deflection only. That's what we have been seeing for a long time. Fine. So it is positive. So now if you take the angle difference between the electrical activity and the AVF, so what is the angle difference here? It is more than 90 or less than 90. It will be positive or it will be negative. What will be the angle difference? It will be more than 90 degrees. Yes, correct. So Dr. Subhash is correct. So it will be more than 90 degrees. So AVF will be negative here. So clear? So it will be a negative deflection because it is more than 90 degrees. So which means it's very clear, whenever one is positive and AVF is negative, it's very clear my cardiac vector should be in this particular quadrant. This is the quadrant that the vector should be there to produce this combination. If you see this combination, means it should be in this quadrant only. There's no doubt about that. So if one is positive, AVF is negative, it means the net cardiac vector is in this region of the pie diagram, which I've shown you. So if this located in this pie, it belongs to left axis or normal axis? It belongs to left axis or normal axis? You can't answer because you can't answer because it belongs to both. Because we are actually finding out which quadrant it is located. We are not actually trying to tell this area or this area. We are just telling somewhere in this quadrant belongs to left axis as well as some of the pi is left for the normal axis as well. So that's why whenever you see this combination that one positive and AVF negative, it could be either a normal axis or it could be a left axis. Very commonly, it will be a left axis, but it could be a normal axis also if you don't see carefully. So how will you find out whether it's a normal axis or left axis? For this, you need to see lead 2. That's very, very important. So if you see lead 2, what is the advantage or idea of seeing this lead 2? If you see this, so why lead 2 is seen? Because if you see the angle difference, AVL is at minus 30 degree and lead 2 is at plus 60 degree. So if it's between AVL and lead 2, if you see net angle, if you see this is a 30 degree and this is another 60 degree, if you see the net angle difference, if you add 30 and 60, what will you get? Please answer fast, swiftly. So if you answer, if you have 30 and 60, what will you get? So what is the net angle difference between AVL and lead 2? 90 degree, of course, yes. You're going to get angle difference of 90 degree between lead AVL and lead 2. So that is why, so because we want to use the 90 degree rule, that is the reason why we are seeing lead 2 now. Suppose, let us assume, so this is a little tricky concept, but suppose if your net electrical vector is located in this particular area, net electrical vector is located in this particular area, let us assume. So one will be positive, AVF will be negative, there is no doubt about that. But what will happen to lead 2? That's what my question is. Now, what is the angle that is created between lead 2 and the electrical vector? It is more than 90 or less than 90? It is more than 90. Definitely, you know that AVL and lead 2, the angle difference between them is 90 degree. If it is located beyond the AVL, then definitely you will be having more than 90 degree angle difference between them. So definitely, in this example, lead 2 will be positive. So it's negative. Lead 2 is negative, then I can tell it is a left axis deviation, because I know the moment you cross this AVL and go, it belongs to the left axis. So that's why it's a left axis. Suppose if your net electrical activity or net cardiac activity is located in this particular area, now you can see that still in this example, because it is located in this particular quadrant, lead 1 will be positive and lead AVF will still be negative. There is no doubt about that. But what is the angle difference that is created between lead 2 and the electrical vector in this example? It is less than 90 or more than 90? It is definitely less than 90 degree, because you know the angle difference between lead 1 and AVL and lead 2 is 90 degree. So if it is within this AVL, means it should be less than 90 degree only. So which means it's going to create a positive deflection. Suppose if you are creating a positive deflection lead 2, then it will be a normal axis. That's the final take home point. So lead 1, lead AVF positive, normal axis. Lead 1 negative, AVF positive, right axis. Lead 1 negative, AVF negative and AVR positive, extreme axis or northwest axis. Lead 1 positive, lead AVF negative, we have to see lead 2. If lead 2 is positive, it's a normal axis. If lead 2 is negative, it indicates a left axis. Do you understand this? How simple the quadrant rule is? Okay. Now let us recap and write everything. So lead 1 and AVF is there. So that this is a nutshell. This is a summary that I'm going to give. So lead 1 positive, lead AVF positive, normal axis. Lead 1 negative, AVF positive, right axis. Lead 1 negative, AVF also negative. It will be a northwest axis, but just confirm with the AVR once. AVR usually will be positive in this northwest axis or extreme axis. Lead 1 positive, AVF negative. It could be a normal axis, or it could be a left axis. So in this, you have to see lead 2. If lead 2 is positive, it indicates a normal axis. If lead 2 is negative, it indicates a left axis. So that's all. All you need to know to find out the frontal plane axis is this thing. That's all. So what we are discussing is the frontal plane axis. This is the ultimate table that you need to know for exam before telling whether what axis the patient is having, the given ECG is having. So whenever they talk about axis, they always talk about frontal plane axis. Even though you have a separately horizontal plane axis, most of the time that is not really important. At least a beginner level, or at least for NEET PG exam, it's not important. So when I talk about axis, we talk about frontal plane axis. You need to deduce the frontal plane axis through the limb leads only, which is very, very important. That's what Ayantavan said. So let me give you some of the ECGs so that you will be able to tell. So what that ECG is particularly showing, whether it's what axis. I'm going to give you some sample problems. Okay, I'm hold on. Okay. So this is a random message I've taken. So just tell me the axis in this particular ECG. So what the axis is there? What axis is it showing? I mean, I don't want the diagnosis. I just want the axis. I just want the axis in this particular case. So you're going to tell what axis it belongs to. I'll give you some more time so you can tell. So what axis belongs to? I'm expecting answers from other people also. Naveen has given some answer. Let us see whether it is right or wrong. But I want other people also to answer. So what do you believe this axis belongs to? Okay. Naveen is telling right, and many people are telling it's normal axis. So this is a very common ECG in your exam. So can you tell, so what lead one shows? Lead one shows a kind of negative deflection. So which is, I mean, maximum here. You see it's a positive deflection that is predominant or negative deflection that is predominant in lead one. Yes, it's a kind of predominantly negative, correct. So if you really zoom, I mean, if not zoom, if you see from outward itself, it's typically predominant. Negative 2, 3, maybe 3.5 to 4. The negative reflection is see like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, almost 8 boxes, 4 to 8. So definitely, you know, like the negative reflection is double than that of the positive reflection. So you don't need zooming, just by seeing from the outside itself, it's typically showing a predominantly negative. So I can assume lead one is predominantly negative. And see the lead AVF. Lead AVF is predominantly positive or negative? Lead AVF is predominantly positive. So where you get this combination? So lead one is negative and lead AVF is positive. Where you really get this combination? Where you get this combination? You have seen here. So lead one is negative and lead AVF is positive. We get that combination when the patient is having a right axis. Yes, this patient is actually having a right axis deviation. That's all. This is actually a case of pulmonary embolism. This is what we call S1. That's a deep S in lead 1 and a Q wave in lead 3 and T wave inversion in lead 3. This is basically S1, Q3, T3 pattern that you see in patients with pulmonary embolism. That's all. So, I mean, nevertheless, pulmonary embolism is one of the important conditions that shows right axis deviation. Clear? Because it produces severe right ventricular strain. So, and that right ventricle will be dilated out and ballooned out. That's why you have a right axis deviation here. So, this is a typical example of right axis deviation, one of the important signs of pulmonary embolism. Any patient with new onset right axis deviation with unexplained shortness of breath in emergency is having a high index of suspicion for pulmonary embolism. Let me show you another ECG. Now, let me add another one so that you will have a much better idea. Okay, so what axis is this? What axis is this? Okay, some are telling left, some are telling normal, but let us see. So what's really happening first? So here, lead one and AVF is the first thing that I need to see. See the lead one here. Lead one is negative or positive? So just answer N or P. That's all. That's enough. Lead one is positive. Yes, fine. And what about lead AVF? Lead AVF is negative or positive? So this is lead AVF. Lead AVF is negative or positive? Of course, lead AVF is negative. There's no doubt about that. So let us see our final table that I have put. Lead one positive, lead AVF negative. I told you it could be a normal axis or it could be a left axis, but you want to see the lead two. So now see the thing in lead two. So what happens in lead two? Lead two is negative or positive? Lead two is of course negative. It's probably negative. So whenever lead two is negative, so what does it belong to? So what axis this belongs to? This is the left axis or a normal axis. So of course, this is a left axis deviation. This patient is having actually a left antrifascicular block. We'll discuss about that later on. Whenever you see a antrifascicular block, one of the typical hallmarks of having a left antrifascicular block is left axis deviation. So that is advanced concept. Now, not now. So this is a very basic primer. So you need to just tell what is the axis. In this particular ECG, it's a left axis deviation. That's all. As simple as that. That's what I need to tell you. And apart from that, you have this one. So you're going to tell what is this axis. I mean, I'm not asking the diagnosis, Dr. Sai. I'm asking about what axis it belongs to. Anyway, Dr. Sai, your diagnosis is wrong, by the way, but still, what axis it belongs to? So you're going to tell what lead one is. So lead one is negative or positive. You can see the lead one here. So lead one is negative or positive. So this is the QRS complex here. Lead one is negative. So of course, yes, lead one is negative. There's no doubt about that. And see the lead AVF. Lead AVF is here. So lead AVF is showing negative or positive. Yes, correct. Lead AVF is also negative. So then I told you, whenever lead one is negative and lead AVF is also negative, very likely not there, confirm with AVR. AVR is showing a full positive or full negative. Yes, AVR is full positive. So this is northwest axis. It's very rare to see in ECG in this axis. If you see in this axis, especially northwest axis, if you see a tachycardia, it's equal to VT. So this is called as Verrecky's sign. Verrecky's sign. What do you mean by Verrecky's sign? VREC positive AVR like this. It usually the arrhythmia that you, the tachyarrhythmia that you see is a ventricular tachycardia. That's what Verrecky's sign tells that. So usually there are very few conditions which produce a northwest axis, like a ventricular ectopic. I mean, when you have a series of ventricular ectopics, you call it ventricular tachycardia. Second, probably you can think about wrong placement of the lead. Suppose if they misplace the lead front value, some abnormal value like this. So that's the second. Third, one electrolyte disturbance that can produce any axis is hyperkalemia. So usually whenever you get a northwest axis or extreme axis, these are only three possibilities. The impulse is from ventricular origin, that's called a ventricular ectopic. Series of ventricular ectopic, ventricular tachycardia. So ventricular ectopic or ventricular tachycardia will produce northwest axis. Sometimes, not all the time, hyperkalemia can produce northwest axis and wrong placement all in the world for producing this northwest. Very, very rare to have this northwest. Even with the VT, northwest axis is rare. But if you have a tachyarrhythmia northwest, it's a VT. So it's like that. So it's very, very rare to have the electrical activity in that particular area. So this is an example of a northwest axis. Let me show you another example, maybe another two more examples so that you can understand things better. Okay, so this is another ECG. What is this axis? Okay, I'm getting some answers, but let us see what lead one is showing. So lead one is showing negativity or positivity? Lead one is negative or positive? Yes, of course, lead one is negative. You can see it's predominantly negative, even though it's small. If you zoom and see, you know, like it's definitely negative, no doubt about it. You have negative complex that is predominant. Then coming down, lead AVF is positive or negative? Lead AVF is positive. So whenever you have a combination of lead one negative, lead AVF positive, lead one negative and lead AVF positive, what is this? It's a right axis deviation. So this patient is having a right axis deviation, and this patient is actually having a left posterior fascicular block. As I told you, left anterior fascicular block typically produce a left axis deviation, and one of the hallmarks of left posterior fascicular block is to produce a right axis deviation. So these are the two hallmarks that you need to know, but nevertheless, don't worry about that right now. We are going to discuss in detail later on in the regular batch sessions. And apart from that, let us take the original ECG, what you have seen in the beginning. So in this particular ECG, what axis you are seeing? What is the axis in this particular ECG? Let me rub the limb leads alone, so just to make sure you see them properly. So what is the axis in this ECG? So the original is the first ECG we saw. Yes, this is sort of a normal axis. Why normal axis? Because you can see the lead one. Lead one is positive and lead AVF is also positive. So we have clearly seen that whenever you have lead one positivity and lead AVF positivity, it belongs to that normal axis quadrant. That's why this is a normal axis. So now I've seen an example. So this is a right axis. This is a left axis. This is an extreme axis. This is another right axis. And we are seeing a normal axis also. So I think now you will be clear how to find out the axis in this, don't you? Do you understand now how to find out the axis? So how you define right axis, how you define a left axis, how you define extreme axis, when you call it as normal axis. So what rule we use is a simple rule. We call it as something called as a quadrant rule. So that's how we find out what axis it belongs to and how you find out a particular axis in a particular electrocardiogram. So now you know the axis. And after that, let us see the differences between segments and an interval, because in ECG you will see something called a segment and you will see something called as an interval. So now let us see that. So now let us take the 12 ED, the normal ECG recording. So, I mean, this is too much of an ask, but still let us see the normal ECG recording. So, you know, this is a P wave. So please understand P wave is due to atrial depression. That's all, as simple as that. So many students think it's due to SA nodal depolarization. Absolutely wrong. SA nodal depolarization will not produce any discernible waveforms in the ECG. You should be 100%, very sure about that. So why I'm telling you that fact again and again is the fact is that the reason is because you might, in certain pathological conditions, you might have an SA node that is firing, but atrium will not depolarize. So in that condition, you will not get the P wave. So you cannot argue that SA node is firing, then you will get a P wave. No, it's not like that. I told you very clearly, P wave is due to atrial depolarization only. Even if the SA node is firing, and if you don't get atrial depolarization, if the atrial depolarization is not present, then you will not get a P wave, and P wave will be absent. Similarly, whenever you have atrial depolarization, even if the SA node is silent, you will still get a P wave. The best example of the first scenario I told you is hyperkalemia. In hyperkalemia, SA node will be active, but atrium will be suppressed because of the electrolyte disturbance, so that the SA node impulse will directly jump from atrium into the AV node called as atrioventricular conduction, sinoventricular conduction. So here the atrium will not depolarize. So you will not get a P wave. One of the hallmarks of hyperkalemia is widening of the P wave and absent P wave, but SA nodes will still be active. Then second example, the example for the second condition I've described is SVT or AVNRT. So in AVNRT, you will have a P wave, but it will be hidden within the QRS complexes, which means atrium will be firing, but SA node will be silent. So which means you have to be absolutely clear in your mind that P wave means atrial depolarization. And there are a lot of pathological conditions where you might have an active SA node, but atrium will not be firing, so you won't have a P wave. And there are a lot of other pathological conditions where atrium will be firing, but SA node will be silent, but still you will be getting a P wave. So to get a P wave, all you need is only one thing, that is atrium to fire, atrium to depolarize, as simple as that. And as I told you, this is a QRS complex. So when you talk about a QRS complex, QRS complex is a sign of ventricular depolarization. That's all. QRS complex is a sign of ventricular depolarization. So again, remember, it's not AV nodal depolarization, it's ventricular depolarization. And T wave is due to ventricular repolarization. We have discussed that already. And you might get a small U wave, but usually that will be not discernible. U wave is due to Purkinje fiber repolarization. That's the current concept. Previously, it's thought to be due to atrial repolarization, but it's not that. It's due to Purkinje fiber repolarization. Usually, the U wave is due to Purkinje fiber repolarization. So, but usually, you don't see this very commonly. If you see a very big U wave, it indicates hypokalemia. That's an electrolyte disturbance. There only you will get a pathologically big U wave. Apart from that, you will get a very minute, or sometimes you won't even see that U wave usually. So these are the different waveforms that you see in the ECG. Now, if I ask you what is this area means, so from this area to this area, so what is this called as? Can anyone tell what is that area called as? So from this area to this area? Basically, this is a QRS complex and this is a P wave. And remember, this is a PR interval. This is a PR interval. Not PQ interval, I mean, even though some German textbook called as a PQ interval, that's valid only. It's a QRS complex, you can call it as a PQ interval also. But traditional terminology, what described by Einthoven is a PR interval only. That's how they have described that. That's why let us stick on to the PR interval name. So why it is called an interval? So previously I told you something called as a PR segment, but why this is called as a PR interval? Suddenly I've changed and told you PR interval. No, it's not like that. So as I told you, only when you have an isoelectric line, when you have an isoelectric line, which means this area. So when you don't have any waveforms, if you have an isoelectric line, that isoelectric lines are the ones that are called as segments. Clear? So when you have a waveform, you cannot call it as a segment. It's an interval. So that's what I want to tell. So what is the difference between a segment and an interval? Remember, segments are isoelectric, which means you have a flat line. You should not have any waveforms in between. Whereas intervals are not isoelectric. It will be wavy. Wavy in the sense it will have waveforms. When you include waveforms, it becomes an interval. You don't include the waveform. If you, you have only the flat line, that isoelectric line, that is basically a segment. So that's a very, very important point. So why? Because intervals are usually, not all the time, intervals are usually measured in horizontal axis. I mean, horizontal direction. So which means intervals are usually measured in this direction. What do you mean by that? It means the time scale is the one that is important for interval. So that is the reason why whenever you talk about an interval, you talk about whether it is prolonged or shortened. Prolonged or shortened. And what is the horizontal direction means is the time scale. So intervals are usually quantified by time scale, whether it is prolonged or whether it is shortened. So that's where you talk about the interval. When you talk about the segment as such, segments are usually measured in the vertical direction. Vertical direction is in the voltage scale. So which means I need to know the amplitude more than the, length. I need the amplitude of the segments are very, very important. So the best example of a segment is the ST segment. So, you know, this is the ST segment. The best example of a segment is an ST segment. So since they are measured in vertical direction, I can call ST segment to be elevated or depressed. Similarly, PR segment can be elevated or depressed. So I will not be measuring in the horizontal direction. So these are the basic difference between segment and interval. Segments are isoelectric, measured in vertical direction. You have to tell whether it's elevated or depressed. Whereas intervals should be measured in the horizontal direction. And you tell whether it is prolonged or shortened because it's in the time scale. So very, very big difference between segments and intervals. You should never confuse. So whenever I talk about a PR interval, that should include a P wave. Very, very important point. It should include the P wave. Without including the P wave, you should not measure the PR interval. Very, very important point. When you talk about the PR segment, it's the isoelectric line between the P wave and the QRS complex is what we call as a PR segment, and that will not include the P wave. PR interval means you should always include the P wave in between. Please take that into your mind. And apart from that, if I ask you what is this, what do you call this? What is this area? What do you call it as? I told you already, isn't it? So I just want you to answer something. So what is that? So that is basically the ST segment. Please tell that's the ST segment. So I can write here. So this is an ST segment because it's isoelectric and does not include any waveform in between. Suppose if I'm writing from here to here, from this point to this point. So here to here. So what is this called as? So, I mean, first of all, tell this is an interval or this is a segment. At a very basic level, this is an interval or this is a segment. Yes, this is an interval. So what interval is that called as? This is a QT interval. This is basically a QT interval. QT interval will span from the beginning of the QRS complex to the end of the T wave, which means how many waves QT interval is including in there. So it includes a QRS complex and it includes a T wave also. So which means QT interval is actually including two waves. So one is the QRS complex and second is the T wave also. So which means how we can remember that PR interval is the first interval. So it includes only one wave, the first wave, that is the P wave. QT interval is the second interval. So it's going to include two waves, the QRS complex and the T wave itself. So how will you define this PR intervals and how you define the QT intervals? So that's what I'm going to see next. So when you talk about the PR interval, so what is the most important determinant? I told you the segments are, I mean, what are the reasons for the segments? In the segments, you don't have depolarization nor you don't have repolarization, which means at a point of completed depolarization or at a point of completed repolarization or at a point of resting state of the membrane, you will not get any changes at all. That's why the line is flat. We discussed that already in the very beginning of the chapter. So when you get the firing, that wave going on, then only you will get these waveforms. So when the atrium is firing, you get the P wave. When the ventricle is firing, you get a QRS complex. When the ventricle is coming back to its original shape, that is to the RMP, the resting state during repolarization, you get the T wave. But what does that interval signify? Segments, I told you what signifies. Segments, that point, you will not have any, waveform going on. It will be either at a completed depolarization or at a point of complete repolarization. But what does that interval signify? Now we know the waveforms, what they mean. Now we know the segments, what they mean. But we don't know what are the intervals. So we have two intervals. One is the PR interval and second is the QT interval. So PR interval signifies there is a difference between the P wave firing and the ventricular firing. So this is where the atrium fires and this is where the ventricle fires, which means PR interval clearly tells from the beginning of the atrial firing to take the ventricles to fire. It always takes time. It needs some time. It's not like the atrium and ventricle fire spontaneously. Always atrium starts firing and it takes some time, then only the ventricle fires. So why does that so? That is because the AV nodal delay is there. There is something called AV nodal delay. So whenever you have a PR interval, if they ask you what the PR interval signifies, it signifies something called as AV nodal delay. So how much ever the AV nodal is delay, proportionately your PR interval will be prolonged or shortened. So that is why whenever you have a bypass tract, whenever you have a tract that bypasses the AV node, so you have a short PR interval. Why? Because AV node has inherent property. AV node is slow. AV node is lethargic. AV node will not conduct faster impulses because it's calcium dependent. AV node is calcium dependent. AV node's fibers arranged in series, in the sense like they don't have, why they are called a series, because they have very reduced gap junctions. Because they don't have much gap junctions and they are calcium dependent depolarization, they'll be slow in their conduction. So we can call that slow conduction as lazy, lethargic, in any way you want, you can call. So the AV node is going to hold the impulse for some time. It's not going to transfer immediately. So once the atrium starts firing, the impulse will be transmitted to the AV node. AV node will not fire immediately, it will hold its slow conduction, hold the impulse for some time, then only it will start the, it will push the impulse into the ventricles, so the bundle of is in the Purkinje fibers. And that is why from the beginning of the P wave, to get the beginning of the ventricular firing, it takes some time. So that time is what we call as the PR interval, and that PR interval is going to signify AV nodal delay. Suppose if the impulse is traveling normally through the AV node, you will get a normal PR. If the AV node is more lazy, some damage to the AV node is happening, the PR interval will become more prolonged. Suppose if you have a bypass tract that bypasses the AV node, so which means the natural property of AV node is to slow down the impulse. If there is a bypass tract that conducts impulses faster than the ventricles, so you'll have a short PR interval. So as a basic primer, you need to know, when the PR interval is prolonged, you think about a problem in the AV node. If the PR interval is shortened, you think about something like a bypass tract, which is very, very important to know. So the PR interval signifies the AV node delay. Why the AV node is slow? Because it's calcium dependent. It has very little gap junctions. So that you can tell that AV node is slow and lethargic. So then next interval is the QT interval. This is the final interval, the basics of the final interval I'm going to tell. QT interval, you know from where to where it extends. You know it starts from the QRS complex and it goes till the completion of the T wave. So till it goes to the completion of the T wave. So beginning of the QRS complex to the end of the T wave is what we refer to as a QT interval. So QRS complex means ventricular depolarization and T wave means ventricular depolarization, which means QT interval is equal to the sum of time taken for ventricle to depolarize and repolarize. That's all. Which means the sum of ventricular depolarization, repolarization and the time taken for it will give you the QT interval. Which means QT interval is nothing but the sum of the time taken for the ventricle to depolarize and repolarize. Clear? So that is what the QT interval is going to signify. So the PR interval, AV nodal delay, QT interval is the time taken for the ventricle to depolarize as well as repolarize is the one that is given by the QT interval. So clear? I think we have discussed on the basics. So a lot of basics have been discussed in this session. So this is going to be just a primer or introduction of what we are going to discuss in our regular next batch. So we have a lot of interesting ECGs and interesting discussions going on. We have almost 120 hours of discussion going on. So we are going to have a huge amount of medicine discussion over there, and medicine is going to be a very important subject for your next. And the concept that we need to know is very, very important, because in exam you don't have much time to remember and tell. So that if you have concepts that are strong in your head, you can easily start answering the questions just by seeing what is happening. So that is why I used to give this kind of nutshell at the end. So why you need this kind of nutshell? Because you, even though you don't really learn everything, so you don't know everything, so finally at the end of the exam, if you learn this kind of tables, that's more than enough. So this table now makes a lot of sense for you. So if you know this, now you know very well how to find out the axis and all this stuff. So that is why usually at the end of the session I used to give kind of a nutshell. So remember, especially when it comes to next or even for a current NEET PG pattern, the concept based discussions are extremely, extremely important. You cannot deny that fact at all. So with this, I think I'm going to wind up the session. But before that, if you are interested in the class and if you like the class, you can put a thumbs up button at the end, and you can dedicate your hats to me, which will be definitely boost my morale for taking the next sessions again and again and again. And I need to also show you this. Batch course for you guys, so that is coming up. So Unacademy is coming up with the next batch course as well as for the NEET batch course, and most of them are face to face. I mean, this kind of a live discussion that's going to go on. So most of them I see you here, and I'm going to answer a lot of doubts, and all the other faculties are also going to do that. The Unacademy is currently having one of the excellent faculty set, and you have the comfort of learning from home, and you have a lot of advantages going on, and it has an excellent MCQ series, crash courses, and so many things are coming up. And as far as the medicine is concerned, I'm going to be the sole owner of medicine when it comes to next, especially in the next year of Unacademy. So I'm looking forward to meet you all guys, and stay tuned till that. My session is going to start on February 27th. Stay tuned. So thank you very much, and for your patient listening. And if you like the session, again, put the thumbs up button. You can dedicate the hats to me, and have a good night. Sleep well. Thank you.